Welcome to 11th lecture, and from 11th lecture now we are getting into finite element analysis. There are two distinct approaches in finite element method. One is the variational approach, which is basically energy minimization approach, which is more sort of closer to the physics, because you know we are calculating the energy and we are minimizing the energy. And why we minimize energy is basically because fields would always get distributed in a given problem domain such that energy content is minimized. That is, you know, is one of the nature's laws. So the fields will get distributed such that energy content is minimized. There is another approach, weighted residual approach, right, wherein we minimize errors because of approximation that we are doing. So we will see this weighted residual approach little later. So the first two set of lectures we will concentrate on this variational approach, which is basically energy minimization. See here, and remember, we are taking again this parallel plate capacitor problem to understand what is this, you know, energy minimization and how energy gets, how you know the field distribution corresponds to energy minimum condition, right. So here always remember that most of these problems that we are taking, particularly in electrostatics, you will find that we are not considering the charges on the plate, because those sources, because the source actually is charge. Always remember, in electromagnetics the basic entity, that source, is charge only. That charge, when it is moving, then it is current. That current can be DC or time varying, but the basic source is charge or current, right. But here, you know, you may wonder, you know, in all these things we are not actually representing charge source, but the charge is represented by the corresponding boundary condition. Here for 100 volts and 0 volts. Now again, for simplicity, we are neglecting the end effects, right. So we are considering, you know, it is like in one of the previous lectures we saw, we actually will terminate this whole geometry here like by these vertical boundaries and impose Neumann, homogeneous Neumann condition, that is dabba V by dabba
Z equal to 0 in this case,
right. Now actually, you know, here since it is a uniform field condition, because end effects are neglected, everywhere the field is uniform, so your electric field intensity is simply 100 volts by 10 meters, because 10 meters is the gap between the two plates. So you have, you know, E given by 10 volts per meter everywhere. And we know the energy is, you know, integral, volume integral, half epsilon E square dV. Now see, it is becoming easy. If I had directly started with FEM, then I would have to explain what is this energy. Now we have covered almost all background theory required for FEM, right. And it will be easier for you to understand electromagnetics aspects of FEM. We have to concentrate more on the maths aspect of the FEM in the lectures that are going to follow. So energy is given by this, and now here this dimension is shown here as x. So you know, you have in yz, it is infinite in yz extent. Remember, when we imposed here homogeneous Neumann condition, effectively, you know, what you are doing is you are making the plate, these plates, infinite in extent in z direction, right. In y anyway, into the paper it is infinite, right. So effectively what we are doing, it is this dv is dx into 1 into 1, like we saw in basics when we did 2D approximation, we always said dx into 1, is it not, per meter depth. And also we saw the parameters are calculated per meter depth, right. So here it is, since it is you are assuming infinite extent in both x and y and z, you have, it is basically your per meter depth in those. So you are, that is why this problem will essentially reduce to 1D, is it not, it is a 1D problem effectively, right. And then we also know for this problem the solution is the equispaced lines, the equipotential lines will be equispaced, is it not? All these lines will be equispaced, right? But you know, let us assume, so by our logic that we just saw, the nature's law, so this should lead to minimum energy condition, right? So we need to prove that this indeed equispaced equipotential lines indeed lead to minimum energy condition. So we will have a counter argument and then sort of prove it, right? So let us assume that no, these equispaced lines is not energy minimum condition. So this dotted line here shown, suppose that line is representing 90% of voltage, which is say 90 volts, right? And the solution is not equispaced line, but one of the lines is not equispaced, it is above the actual solution as. But then now what you will see, the energy in this, only if you consider energy in this region up to this 80 volts, energy up to 80 volts line, in the previous case when it is exact solution, the energy will be proportional to 10 square plus 10 square, because E was 10, is it not? 10 volts per meter. So E square, 10 square plus 10 square, that will be proportional to 200. But in case of dotted line, you will have, assume that since this line is taken above, in the top, this region between the top plate and this dotted line, the electric field intensity will be more, is it not? And that I have assumed that it is say 11 volts per meter. And in this case, between 80 volt and 90 volt, now the electric field intensity will be lower, which I am taking it as say 9 volts per meter. Now you can see, 10 square plus 10 square is 200, and 11 square plus 9 square is 202, is it not? So this, that is why the dotted case would represent higher energy than the exact solution. So in a way, we have proved that in this case, the equipotential lines, equispaced equipotential lines
lead to the
minimum energy condition, right. So now actually, if you take the other case wherein which also we have been seeing previously, lead to ground. Now here, the equipotential lines are going to be like this, is it not? We have seen that earlier. Now these lines are not equispaced. The actual exact solution of this would correspond to equipotential lines which are not equispaced, because the lines which are closer to the conductor, they will be more closely spaced as compared to equipotential lines which are towards this ground electrode, they will be sparsely spaced, right. So now here in this case, the exact solution corresponds to this non-equispaced equipotential lines. And in this case, suppose you assume equispaced equipotential lines, then in fact you will calculate higher energy than the exact solution, which is non-uniform case and not equispaced lines. Is this point clear? Right. Now here equispaced lines, that you will have to from the FEM solution, you will have to work out then, and that is not very straightforward to calculate. It was very simple in case of parallel plate capacitor to prove, but here it would be difficult. But I hope intuitively you understood why energy minimum condition is the exact solution from the previous capacitor problem. Now let us go further. So we are considering, again I am repeating, it is a source free electrostatic problem, because we are not considering charges on the plates, right, but that source of charges is being represented by corresponding boundary conditions on the top and bottom plate, and the corresponding energy is given by what is written there. Now before going into details of this, how to solve this electrostatic problem, let us see the two more standard partial differential equations. PDE stands for partial differential equation in electromagnetics. So we will be basically considering three cases typically for low frequency electromagnetics when we are dealing with electrical machines and equipment. One is the magnetostatic case, del square A is equal to minus mu j, where A and J are vectors. Now again you are very comfortable with this equation, is it not? Poisson's equations for magnetostatics, where A is the magnetic vector potential, J is the current density. The second equation also we have seen, you know, we had some discussion also on this. I also explained you, you know, this. This is the induced eddy current term, right? Because this dA by dt is the induced electric field intensity. So, sigma dA by dt is J induced, right? So, that is why the units are matching, because the unit is mu times J. So, this is also mu times induced eddy current density. Is it clear? Okay. So, del square A will be equal to minus mu J if it is a static case. If it is a general transient case, this will be the case wherein this is the source current and this is the, this is representing the eddy current. And as I mentioned in that previous lecture, when you bring this on this side, this sign becomes plus, and as it should be, because source current and induced eddy current, they should have opposite sign, right? But their angle will not be exactly 180 degrees, mind that. So that will depend, because these will be all phasors and the angle will get decided by, you know, many other considerations, but maybe little later we will discuss this. But in general, the sign should be opposite. And now if you actually are dealing with time harmonic case, that means if your quantities are varying sinusoidally with, you know, time, then you can convert d by dt as j omega, and then you get this expression, where now this A and J, they are phasors. I have not, you know, represented by another symbol for sake of, you know, brevity and simplicity, right? But remember this, in this thing A and J, they will be phasors. Now let us go further. So now we have to minimize this. Now we are going back to electrostatic problem. So first we will, in this, you know, remaining course, what we will do is we will start with electrostatic, then we will go to magnetostatic fields, then we will go to time harmonic, then we will go to, you know, axisymmetric, we will get into permanent magnets, we will go into transient, then forces, coupled circuit field, and in that complexity we are going to proceed in this course. So again, you know, always electrostatics is probably the simplest thing to analyze. So we are starting with electrostatics. So you know, you are minimizing this, and this we have already seen this. For 1D electrostatics, you get 1 into 1, so it is basically only dx. Now here, for a standard, you know, capacitor problem, we knew that the energy is this, because it is related to, you know, capacitor, and then half epsilon E square is the energy density, right? And that is why we started directly with, you know, assuming that this is the energy that has to be minimized. But in general, you know, how do we sort of, for a given partial differential equation, we have to know its energy, the corresponding energy to be minimized, right? So we will later on see how do we, you know, find out the corresponding energy functionals that need to be minimized for each of these, you know, partial differential equations, right? So then we are coming to an important concept of what is known as functional. Now functional is basically is the energy. So functional is nothing but the energy. So in variational calculus, we basically term energy as functional. So functional F phi. Now this phi here is potential, right? That is the reason, you know, in the previous, in the basics, we, you know, called flux by psi, because, you know, it will otherwise interfere with this symbol of, you know, potential. So here phi is the potential. It could be in general electric potential, magnetic potential, or any potential, right? It is generally, it is a phi, okay? In this case, if you are dealing with electrostatic, it will be, you know, electric potential V, okay? So this is V for electrostatics. Now in this case, this functional, it can be defined in general of this form, P1 to P2, that means this, there is a, this is a one dimensional domain, so this is a one dimensional domain, so it could be, this is a one dimensional domain, So this is x and this is say phi, right, and this is say p1, this is p2. So this is a one dimensional domain from p1 to p2, right, and say potential may be varying between this like this, it may vary in any way. I just shown by a straight line, but it did not, it can vary depending upon the boundary conditions and the source conditions, right. So here now, for example, so this functional energy can be in general represented by f of x phi phi dash. So phi dash is the derivative, right. Now here, for example, if you compare here this functional for electrostatic case, here only what is appearing here, only v dash, because E is nothing but dv by dx, is it not? So only v dash is, or phi dash is appearing. So this E is nothing but this phi dash. So for this case is only, you know, it is a energy is function of only phi dash, but in general it will not be so, it will be generally in the function of x phi phi dash. For example, in case of a Poisson's equation, you will get, you know, it as a function of phi also, that we will see later. So there will be some term in this expression which will be function of phi, right. So here, so then you have one independent variable for this case, and dependent variable is phi. Phi is the potential, right. So you know, you have this in Laplace equation only phi dash appears in functional, and as I mentioned Poisson's equation phi also appears. So we will go further. So this is what we said, and then Laplace equation only phi dash appears in the energy functional, but later on we will see Poisson's equation for PD, for the corresponding functional for Poisson's equation will have phi term also. Now we will go further and discuss more about this functional f and the corresponding variational calculus, right. Now here we know total differential d capital F is dabba f by dabba x into dx, dabba f by plus dabba f by dabba phi into d phi, plus dabba f by dabba phi dash d phi dash, right. But when it comes to variation in f, in variation in f, when we are doing, we are not varying x. So that is why we are saying del x is equal to 0. What it means, we know that, you know, we want to minimize this energy which is represented by capital F. That energy, when we will get minimized, when it will get minimized, when we vary potential at
each point,
and for one combination of potentials at various points, we will get minimum energy. So what we are doing is, in this figure, now this is one dimensional domain, there are so many points x and there are so many points here. At each of these points we will vary the potential values, right. So at this point, example, for example, we are varying potential from some initial guess value to something higher value. So at this point it is varied like this. So at every point we are varying the potential, but we are not varying x, we are not varying potential as function of x. So we are at every x we are varying potential, right. So that is why here we are varying potential, so that is given by del phi. So there is variation, we are doing variation in phi. Similarly, as phi is varied, phi will be a function of x, so phi dash also will vary. So again there will be variation in phi dash. So there, as you vary potential, there will be variation in potential derivative also, but we are not varying del, we are not varying x. That is why here del x here will be 0, that is why this term is not there. So dabba f by dabba x into del x, this term will be 0 because del x is equal to 0. So this is the main concept in when we do variation. So again, you know, del phi is variation in phi at fixed x. So this is the
various phi distribution that we are attempting
to minimize the functional f, which is the energy. Now here let us come to this graph, now this figure. Now here what you see is variation of f with respect to phi. Now remember this, when we are saying this phi and this phi plus del phi, this is a set of values. Now suppose if there are say 100 points here, say, and we calculate the energy associated with, you know, 100 points, so and the corresponding total energy, what will happen is this phi will correspond to a vector of 100 values, right? So all those 100 values will decide the energy of that region, one dimensional region. So now if you change the potentials or at those 100 points, you will get new set of values of potential that will give another this kind of potential versus x, and that may give some other energy value. So now when actually you are approaching the minimum energy point, what will happen when you suppose, for example, this is the minimum energy potential distribution. Now if you change the potential values at all the nodes by some small value, it is not going to lead to any appreciable change in the total energy content. So that means we have reached the minimum. So that is the meaning of this statement. Del F, capital F, is equal to F phi plus del phi is equal minus F phi is equal to 0. When this becomes 0, that means we are near the minimum energy point, this will lead to 0, and that is the, that corresponding phi is the solution, right. Now you know, let us expand this further. So what does this mean? F of phi plus del phi is nothing but F of x plus del x phi plus del phi, phi dash plus del phi dash integrated over, you know, this domain with dx as you know, integration distance, minus this f phi as it is. Now again I just want to repeat, f is just function which is function of x phi phi dash, integral f dx is capital F. So functional f, capital F, is function of function, right. So this is again to just highlight the difference between capital F and small f. Now this expression, this equation, if we further simplify this, you know, by using standard rule that f of x plus h is equal to f x plus h f dash x, and there are, remembering that there are two variables here, this and this, and this the del x is equal to 0. So that's why it will be only f of x and then this, because del x is equal to 0. So that's why here, you know, you get as written here. So now you have only two variables here. This will get expanded to this plus this, right, by the formula that I just mentioned previously. So now this term can be written as this, daba f by daba phi. I am now just omitting this thing for simplicity. And now this g, remember this g is del phi is gx, g as a function of x, because this variation at every point is a function of x, because here the variation is small, here the variation is bigger, here again it is becoming smaller. So the variation that we are making in phi is function of x, right. So that is why g is a function of x, and that is nothing but del phi. So this we are writing it like this, and then this term we are, you know, splitting by using integration by parts, and this is a standard integration by parts. And then this term, first term there, which is rewritten here, that becomes 0, because at when the, that term evaluated at boundaries, it will be, this will reduce to 0 because g is 0 at the boundaries, because potentials are already fixed at the two boundary points, right. So this becomes 0, and then these two terms, this term and this term, these two terms are combined, this is 0. So you get integral of this equal to 0. So when this is, this integral is equated to 0, we are basically minimizing the energy, right. So if this has to be zero and if energy has to be minimum, effectively this integrand has to be zero, because for any arbitrary g x, g of x, this whole thing can be zero only if this is zero, right. So this is called as Euler-Lagrange equation, and this u bracketed term is called as Euler-Lagrange expression, right. Now let us see some application and example to understand what we just now saw in little bit more depth. Now let us again take a parallel plate capacitor problem, and we know the functional for that is half integral epsilon e square dx, right, and is one dimensional, that is why this dv reduces to simply dx into 1 into 1, right. So now e is nothing but dv by dx, right, and then that is why f becomes half, the function becomes half epsilon dv by dx whole square, right, dv by dx square, and then integral f dx is nothing but capital F. Now if we substitute, now if we suppose we want to solve this capacitor problem and find out the distribution, we will assume some potential distribution V, right. If that potential distribution V is exact solution and we know it, then when it is substituted in this Euler-Lagrange equation, the energy will be minimized because solution is known and it is exact. So when you substitute in Euler-Lagrange equation, you will get it equal to 0, and that is what, so here we are assuming that this V is known, exact solution is known, and when it is substituted in this Euler-Lagrange expression, we will get on the right hand side 0. And then if that energy gets minimized in that way, this V is known exactly. Now let us see, when in Euler-Lagrange equation, when you substitute this f and then further simplify, you will get this as d2v by dx square equal to 0. So this we are getting Laplace equation in 1D. So when this exact solution say was known to us and we substituted in Euler-Lagrange expression,
we will have the minimum energy condition, and therefore the right hand side of the equation will be 0, satisfying Euler-Lagrange equation. This further leads to d2v by dx square equal to 0, which is Laplace equation.
So again I want to highlight this, here f was only function of v dash dv by dx, but in general it can be function of x, v and v dash. We will see such examples in some other cases later. Thank you.